Hello students, welcome once again. In our last lecture, we were doing the definition of national income, and the definition was, national income is the sum of money value of all goods and services produced by normal residents in the domestic territory of a country in an accounting year. Let us explain few terms used in this technical definition of national income. First is normal residents. By resident, we mean those individuals and institutions whose economic interest lies in that country where they live. They are called as normal resident because they normally live in the country in which they have their economic interest. But the period of their stay should be at least 1 year or more. This term includes both nationals and non-nationals residing in a country for more than a year. Therefore, a foreigner can also be a normal resident. Like Americans living in India are normal residents of India but are not the nationals of India. Similarly, Indians living outside India are nationals of India but normal residents of that country in which they live for at least 1 year. After resident, second key term in the definition is economic or domestic territory of a country. Gross domestic production is defined as gross market value of all the final goods and services produced in the domestic territory of a country during an accounting year. The concept of domestic territory has a special meaning in national income accounting. By domestic territory, a layman, a common man means political frontiers of a country. But in national accounting, it has a special meaning and is much bigger than the political frontiers of a country. Economic territory is a geographical territory administered or controlled by a government within which persons, goods, and capital circulate freely. The following items are included in the domestic territory. First, territory lying within the political frontiers of a country, and it includes territorial water also. Second, ships and aircrafts owned and operated by the residents of the country between two or more countries. Example, Indian ships moving between United Kingdom and Pakistan regularly, or passenger planes operated by Air India between Russia and Japan are parts of domestic territory of India. Third item included in the definition of domestic territory is fishing vessels, oil, natural gas rigs, floating platforms operated by the residents of a country in the international waters or engaged in extraction in areas where country has exclusive rights of operation. For example, fishing boats operated by Indian fishermen in the international waters of the Indian Ocean will be considered as a part of domestic territory of India. Fourth item included in domestic territory is embassies, consulates, and military establishments of the country located abroad. Example, Indian embassies in Russia, America, and other countries will form part of domestic territory of India. Similarly, embassies of other countries like Japan, Russia, located in India are domestic territories of their own countries, not of India. But remember, international organizations which are physically located within geographical boundaries of India are not included in the domestic territory of India. Their offices form part of international territory, not of domestic territory. Now, how national income is estimated? The first official estimation of India's national income by the government was made for the year 1948-49 and 1949-50. This estimation was made by National Income Inquiry Committee. This committee was set up in 1948. The government of India created a special organization who has been estimating India's national income from the year 1949 to 51 onwards. Every year, Central Statistics Officer presents a white paper on income entitled National Accounts Statistics, which contains all the relevant aggregates of national income. National income is measured on two bases, either at current prices or at constant prices. When we say that national income is the single measure of economic growth of a country, we mean national income at constant prices. See how. If goods and services produced in a year are valued at current prices, that is, prices prevailing in that particular year, we get income at current prices. For example, when goods and services produced during the year 2014-15 are valued at prices of the same year, that is, at the prices of year 2014-15, it will be called national income at current price because we are using the current price. Clearly, in determining national income at current prices, not only physical output produced during the year is important, but also the prices prevailing in that year are equally important. Now, what is national income at constant prices? If goods and services produced in a year are valued at fixed prices, that is, prices of the base year, we get national income at constant prices. A base year is a carefully chosen year, which is a normal year, free from price fluctuations. Now, in India, year 99-2000 is treated as base year. For example, if goods and services produced during the year 2014-15 are valued at the prices of the base year, that is, at the prices of the year 99-2000, it will be called as national income at constant prices for the year 2014-15. Do you know, national income at constant prices is known as real national income, whereas national income at current prices is known as nominal national income. Why this is so? Let's see why income at constant price is treated as real national income. Let us take an example for making our concept more clear. Suppose if units produced in a year are 100 and the price in this first year is rupees 10 per unit, then the national income at current price will be 100 units into rupees 10 per unit, that is equals to 1000 rupees. Now, if in the year 2 also units are produced the same as 100 in the previous year 1, but the rate in year 2 increases to rupees 12 per unit, then the national income in year 2 at current prices is rupees 1200, that is 100 units into rupees 12 per unit. But it shows that national income has increased by rupees 200 in year 2 comparatively to year 1. But do you agree it? This is not so, as the production level is same at 100 units in both the years. That is why national income at current price is not considered as real. This example shows that if the current prices rise rapidly, national income at current price will also rise, even if there is no increase in the level of physical output. And in such circumstances, national income at current price does not give the true picture and fails to reflect the growth in real national output. Whereas national income at current prices is affected by two factors, change in price and change in physical output. On the other hand, national income at constant prices is affected only by one factor, that is change in physical output, as price is fixed. Here, national income at constant prices can rise only when there is a real increase in the level of physical output, because here prices are kept fixed. This is national income at constant prices, which enable us to make a year-to-year comparison of changes in the volume of output of goods and services. It is also helpful in making international comparisons of economic performance of different countries. So, it is proved that national income at constant prices shows real picture. Now, next concept for our consideration is gross domestic production at factor cost and gross domestic production at market price. Gross domestic production means gross domestic product. Conceptually, the national income estimated at market price or at factor cost must be the same, because the final value of goods and services, that is the market price, must be equal to the cost involved in their production, that is factor cost. But there is an important point to be noted that the market value of goods and services is not the same as the earnings of the factors of production. Actually, the market price of goods and services includes indirect taxes as they are levied on the commodities, and subsidies are excluded from the market price of goods and services. So, gross domestic production at market price includes indirect taxes and excludes the subsidies given by the government. Therefore, we must subtract indirect taxes from gross domestic production at market price as they are included in it, and we must add subsidies to gross domestic production at market price as they are excluded from it. Only then we can arrive at gross domestic production at factor cost. Symbolically, we can say that GDP at factor cost, that is gross domestic production at factor cost, is equal to gross domestic production at market price minus indirect taxes plus subsidies. Now, what is indirect tax? Indirect taxes are those taxes which are levied by the government on production, sale and import of commodities, like excise duty is a tax on production, sale tax is a tax on sale, custom duty is a tax on import export. These are called indirect because buyer of a commodity pays the tax indirectly to the government. The effect of indirect tax is that it increases the market price of a commodity. Subsidies. Subsidies are cash grants given by the government to the enterprises to encourage production of certain commodities or to promote export. Subsidies are opposite of indirect taxes, because the effect of subsidy is fall in the price of a commodity. If you remember, we also did in microeconomics that taxes decrease the supply and grants increases the supply due to effect on their market price. Let's discuss two more concepts which looks same, but in fact there is a difference between the two. And these two terms are personal income and personal disposable income. Personal income is the sum of all incomes actually earned by an individual during a given year. Here I want to tell you that an individual derives income from five sources, and they are income from salary if he is in job, income from house property if he has let out any of his residential property, income from business or profession if he is doing his business or profession, income from capital gains if he sells any of his capital assets, and income from other sources in the form of interest, dividend, etc. Now, if personal taxes are deducted from this personal income of the individual derived from these five sources, what is left is called his personal disposable income, which is equal to consumption and saving. After the concept of personal income and personal disposable income, next term to discuss is per capita income. Per capita income is average per capita income. It is income per head of population living in a country. It is measured by dividing national income by mid-year population of a country. Like national income, per capita income is also calculated both at current prices as well as at constant prices. But it is per capita real income, that is per capita income at constant prices and not at current price, which is better measure of economic growth. Increase in per capita real income is considered to be a better measure of economic growth because it gives some idea about the rising standard of living. Prosperity of a country depends not only on the size of its national income but also on the number of people who would share it. Let us take an example. Suppose the national income of a country 1 is rupees 1 lakh and its total population is 10,000. Then the per capita income will be national income 1 lakh upon total population 10,000 equals to rupees 10 per person. Simultaneously, if in the country 2 also the national income is rupees 1 lakh but the total population here is rupees 20,000, that is double. Now, per capita income here will be only rupees 5 per person, that is half. It is clear with the help of this example that the standard of living per person in a country with large national income having smaller population will be higher than the one of a country with equally large national income but having large population. So, students, with this description of per capita income, we have to stop here. Let's revise what we have done today. Today we started with the meaning of two terms, normal residence and domestic territory, used in the definition of national income. Then, national income at current price and its difference with national income at constant price. Then, gross domestic production at factor cost and at market price. We come to know that the difference between the two is due to indirect taxes and subsidies. Indirect taxes are included and subsidies are excluded in gross domestic production at market price. Then what we did was the concept of personal income and personal disposable income. And last topic, discussion of per capita income. The methods of measuring national income will be discussed in the next lecture. Till then, thank you.